What's up? What's going on, people? How are you? Hey, can you hear me? That's always a thing, though. I'm never sure if it's going to work. I've taken to, I have to turn the phone off and then turn it back on. Woo! Man, it's kind of cold in my studio right now, I'll tell you. It is Thursday. Oh, you're in Jacksonville. Hola, Paul. What's going on? You can't hear me. Oh, you do see me and hear me. I don't have my glasses. I got something in my throat. One second. Man, I gotta say, people, I had a great time yesterday. The lunch break with Emerson was fun, and then I did a live stream. I played like, I don't know, 45 minutes or so on this live stream, which was great. And I think I started drinking before the live stream at like 4 o'clock. And then after the live stream, someone suggested that I do an after party, Instagram Live after party. So I did an after party, and that was super fun. I played like weird demos and stuff, and yeah, it was it got crazy. And then later in the night, Hendrix, my 3-year-old, came out in the studio, and he wanted to mess around with the microphone. So let me see if I can find one of these. So this is, can you see that? You can kind of see that. It's good enough. This is him yesterday.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Hendrix William Harris learning what delay is. Go.
No matter how you would do that. No matter how you would.
Oh, whoa, that's crazy. Hold on.
No matter how I would do that.
We're wilding out in here.
Go.
Turn it up.
Bossing me around.
Pretty loud.
Turn it up.
Anyway.
Turn what part up?
Scare it to bath.
He's gonna be in the Screamcore band, no doubt. I was losing my mind laughing so hard. So yeah, we did that, and I just all around I had a great time yesterday. That was really fun. So thank you guys, those of you that tuned in, for any one of those things. So yeah, I don't know what to talk about today. How you doing? How you guys making it through? I went to the grocery store today. Yeah, Alice was bossy pants telling me to turn it up. Turn it up. I went to the store today. It was cool. I had my first legitimate, not made up kind of mask, which was cool. I had to get the whole thing where you put the mask underneath your glasses because my glasses kept fogging up. but I made it through. I have no big incredibly profound things to say to you today. What gear do I use in my studio? For what? What kind of guitars or what kind of saw? Yeah, I don't know, all kind of stuff. Working from home. I don't have a whole lot to say, so my phone already. Okay, cool. I'm gonna play a song right quick. As people keep at which DAW? I use Pro Tools and Logic, and now Luna, the new Universal Audio thing. Which I really, really like. No, I'm not gonna play Turnaround right now. I'm gonna play something else. Thank you. wanna be. Time. Don't make me lose my mind. Baby, 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 can't you stay with me tonight? Find beautiful ones, they hurt you every time. Paint a perfect picture. Bring to life a vision in one's mind. The beautiful ones always smash the picture. Always. Every time.
If I told you, baby, that I was in love with you, oh, baby. We got married.
Tell me soon, won't that be cool?
You make me so confused. Beautiful ones, you always seem to
song. That's a good one. It's a good one. I had never learned that song. I learned it when Prince died. I was like, I should learn that song because I wasn't sure which song I was going to play in tribute to. So I got a guest. I'll get to my guest. Don't cry, Alice. My next guest I have known for the better part of close to 30 years. So longer than some of you guys have been alive. We met in Atlanta. We struck up, he's also a singer, songwriter, and did it at a really high level. So I think at the beginning, there was a little bit of that sort of the dance you see when you see like two tigers or two wildcats sort of walk around each other and kind of check each other out. It's like, oh, okay, cool. I think we're cool. We are two in the same, and over the years, we've figured out, I think we call each other emotional twins. We sort of feel things, and very, very similar ways, and our relationship is a relationship I'm profoundly happy to have. Definitely a North Star for me musically. Probably the best person doing it in the game at this current juncture. I don't know if he's logged in right now. Let's see. This is my least favorite part of the show. Wait. All right. Suspense is killing you guys, right? Let me see. Lunch break guest. Let's see. Wait, let me check my bat phone. Oh. Yeah. Are you in? Wait, let me text him on this other phone. Talk amongst yourselves. I was going to run you guys through this hilarious exchange I had with this person. I got an email from someone that I actually know saying, hey, I got this email from you asking for money. And I was like, that wasn't me. Hold on. I can't tell if he's in. No, don't see him. Wait. I'll make sure I gave him the right credentials. I like that. You said you're never going to take live shows for granted again. I don't think you should. Right here working for the money. Hold on. I'm texting on two phones. I'm texting on two phones and it's working out right. I see my lunch break guest. Ladies and gentlemen, today's guest, Mr. John Mayer.
Hello.
What's up, man?
How are you? I've been here the whole time. I don't want people to think that I was like Mr. Late. I've been here the whole time. It was a beautiful intro. Thank you. Beautiful song. Brought back a lot of memories of touring.
Yes, right?
Yeah. It's good to see you, man. Thank you for that intro. That was amazing.
This is the most I've ever seen. I've known you almost 30 years. I don't know if it's just a little bit of the light.
No, I've decided that this is my one chance to see what could happen if I don't shave.
Uh-huh.
It's the only time that there would be this built-in inference that like, oh, he's not shaving because he's doing this desert island thing. So I'm just very curious about what my face can do with hair. and I'm seeing where it's going. But I mentioned the other night on Current Mood that I think when I first kind of, you know, went underground, as we all have, I decided that I wanted to pause life there.
Right.
And do something that looked different every time I looked in the mirror, with the idea that when this is over, I just shave and maybe mentally I just
go back,
splice the two places together. And also, like, now I'm just into watching what happens with it, and I'm learning things about a quote-unquote beard.
Right.
Do you use scissors on your beard?
Oh God, no. I'm not that savvy. Like, I've used with my hair or my beard, I have clippers, and I'm like, all right, whatever the shape of my head or my face is, that's just what it'll be.
Well, I'm very patchy. I mean, I have a robust hairline. And I'm not going to complain about anything else on my face, but it's very patchy. And here's what's interesting: the hair here is very coily. And the hair here just comes straight out.
Right.
And so that's why I look in the mirror and I go, oh, I have to cut that part. And then this part where I want it to come down is very coily.
Well, do you don't think if like you let this part go, that eventually it would just give up and go off? And
there is no eventually with this hair, with this facial hair. I was given a lot of good things. I'm never going to be able to grow a beard. Now, where that's interesting is that I have to really stay on my diet and my fitness, because I can never just grow in a jawline. I'm always going to be exposed here.
I got
what is the most self-conscious part of your face?
Right here.
Yeah, mine too, right here. But then maybe everybody is, and therefore nobody has to be.
Yeah, but I mean, it's just like, the great angles on Instagram. It's like we all look like whatever, but you still try to get the best angle possible just because that's what everybody does.
What's your best angle into a camera right now? I assume you're doing it, but if you're not, what is it?
You know, I was telling somebody this yesterday. You know how you see some people in person that you've seen online and you're like, oh my God, they must always pick the great angles because they don't really look that great. Yes. I'm the opposite. My angles on Instagram are awful. But when you see me in person, you're like, oh wow, it's actually much better looking than I thought.
I think you're incredible looking in real life. I've never thought that your angles on Instagram, I mean, we are experts in our face.
Right.
I will say that I have a beautiful 2 to 3 degrees of angle of view. I mean,
you got to get in the 2 to 3 degrees.
Would you like to see it?
Yeah, let's see it.
Like even this is not great, but you start going to this. Okay.
All right.
Pretty good. Now, that's a better side, but I want to show you. As soon as you go here, it's straight to hell.
What is it? I mean, this thing, I'm telling you, I would get surgery if I knew that it could go away. And I don't want any of the rest of my face. I keep that's wrinkles, right. Gray, that's whatever. Make right. It go away. I would do commercials for it. I would be unapologetic.
So there is something, it's called Kybella. It's
I looked into it.
It's injections.
Yeah.
Have you ever done injections? Have you ever had anything done to your face cosmetically?
No.
Me neither.
Do you know anybody that's done Kybella?
I know people I think probably have because I was like, I'm concerned about this. And they're like, Kybella. Kybella. Kybella.
What are you drinking?
I mean, if you're fast on the draw with the name of an injection, you probably used the injection. Yeah.
Is that tea, coffee? What are you, chocolate
milk? It's coffee, which I have to be careful of because coffee during an interview can make your mouth run a little faster than your brain.
All right. Right.
Let me ask you a question. You mentioned something about, you said you were drinking yesterday before one of your lives.
Yeah.
Now I've cut that out. But I do have a question for someone I used to drink with. How has this crisis changed how drinking feels? What's different about drinking now? What would I feel different if I were drinking during this?
Okay, so a couple things. I talked to a friend of mine yesterday, and she said she's dealing with her kids at home. Mm-hmm. She's, you know, kids are home from school, and she's like, in the middle of the day, I went out on the patio, and I chugged a beer. She's like, I'm 42 years old. I have never chugged a beer in my life. She's like, I just had to chug a beer. So there's something about drinking where I feel like I'm doing something kind of bad because I'm drinking.
Yeah, I think that's exactly what I just pulled out of what you said.
Yeah.
Is that there's a little bit of anarchy in there, a little bit of cathartic anarchy.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. There's also something about it just sort of expands the number of colors inside your home.
Right.
You're like, I got to make right. something feel different inside.
Right. Right. I guess the analogy is being a sailor at sea for months at a time. Like 100%. That's why they just totally stock the ship full of rum or booze or whatever.
100%.
Yeah.
So are you finding I guess you haven't had a drink for 2 years, 3 years?
3 years, over 3 years. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Which is fine. I always tell myself now, and it wasn't an AA thing. I managed to find a way to have it make sense on my own. But I always tell myself now, like, if you think about doing it again, you've just tallied up the pros and cons wrong. Do it again.
Right.
Right. You know, it's just for me. I mean, you could see on the chart where when I stopped, my productivity just went through the roof. I can do anything at any time of day. You know, when you stop drinking, you'll be on a treadmill at like 1 a.m. being like, this is amazing.
Yeah. I'm with you 100%. And I mean, you've remained remarkably fun. A lot of people quit drinking and I don't know, just not fun anymore.
You have to be very careful when you excise that little tumor that you don't take out other tissue. That's highly important to your functionality.
Yeah.
You know, I don't hook up anymore, really. I realized that alcohol was the air bridge, as they say now, between two strangers.
Yes.
Yeah.
I said when I quit drinking, I was sober for like 3.5 years. Mm-hmm. And I did the whole AA thing, which was incredibly helpful in a lot of respects because I never really dealt with emotions. I didn't like to talk about emotions. I didn't really think that was a thing. And that's kind of like all they do is talk about emotions.
Right.
But I realized like I wasn't an alcoholic. I was just an asshole, incredibly selfish. And I just used alcohol
for
me to be able to say, oh, that wasn't me. I was drunk. It was something I wanted to do anyway.
Yeah, I think everybody, I don't know how exciting this conversation is, so I'm sorry if I sent it in the wrong direction, but I think there's a lot of people who just need to know that it is, for many, 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 many people, a rite of passage to discover it,
yep.
use it, overuse it, and put it away.
Yes.
It's like, I don't even think we have dug the trench correctly to explain that process. All we have is, I don't drink, I do drink, or I'm now sober because I'm a recovering alcoholic. And I think there are some shades in between that
sure.
go, I didn't for a long time, I did, it helped me, it was awesome, and then it stopped being awesome, and I didn't want to do it anymore.
Yeah, I mean, for me, like going to AA, I realized it was almost like me going and taking my, like if I had a relative that had like cancer medication, and I
right.
just kept like taking their cancer medication. It's like, oh, this works, but this is not, this isn't my medicine.
Didn't need it anymore. I almost feel like I graduated from that university. Now, sure. I was also an asshole in my life too, and that was a different recovery process, but they don't have an AA for assholes.
Man, they totally should.
I mean, it is a little, getting canceled is sort of like, you know, the problem with getting canceled is that nobody has written the kind of, I don't know, the protocol for being uncanceled. Like,
sure.
there's no recovery from but I think if you're canceled, you that might be asshole rehab. I don't know.
Yeah, forced asshole rehab.
You're getting thrown into rehab. The problem is they just, I don't know that anybody's written the curriculum for getting out of the spanking machine.
Sure. Sure.
I don't know. How's this going for you so far?
I said yesterday, now that I realize all I'm doing is rationing patience, and I'm just,
yes. like, yeah.
Some people aren't working. So they're like, they're watching their bank account. Like, okay, I can only do this.
Yeah.
I'm kind of doing that with my patients. Like, all right,
yeah.
I got so much over here and I got to wait till it regenerates.
You know what I say? Don't rattle the bars.
Right.
You are in a confined space.
Yes.
Hang out on the other side of that confined space. Don't walk up to the bars and do this.
Right, right, right.
Don't rattle the bars. They will not move, and you'll just get frustrated.
Just get frustrated, yeah.
I want to be the guy in the sort of prison cell who's off in the corner going, shake all you want, we're not getting out. I want to be that guy.
That's great. Man, I'm glad that I'm just thinking about being inside. I always mean to text you or call you and tell you thank you for this thing you turned me on to. That little nebula projector thing.
Oh, it is so much fun.
So we have this room in the house that was like, it's between me and Sloan's room and the kids' room. And it's just like too big to be a closet, but too small. It's just a weird room. But we were like, well, what if we just took all the stuff off the wall? And we use that little projector in there. We put two beanbags in there. And now it's like the beanbag movie room. So
great.
That's been great. But so this weekend, we're like, you know what? This is spring break. And the kids will not remember this year. As like we have nothing fun planned. We were supposed to go to San Francisco and see a Giants game. So I was like, we got to come up with something. At least one night where we do something great. So tomorrow night, we're going to go camping. We're going to move the sofa and everything out of the way in our living room. We have a fireplace in the living room. We're going to light a fire. I bought this screen on Amazon. It's like $25. And we're just going to hang it in the middle of the room, lay there, watch movies, do s'mores in a sleeping bag. But it's like the nebula
it
makes this whole thing possible. It's the best $100 I've ever spent.
It's great. It's a soda can size. It's a little bigger than a soda can. It's a wireless projector of any media you want to throw at it. And I am 11. I'll always be in some ways an 11-year-old boy. And anything that lights up or projects
yeah.
in a room is like wireless. A way to totally change the room. So I'm like super freaking out on Philips Hue, those
yeah.
lights now.
Yeah.
I mean, you should see. I mean, I have them on order for all different places because it's hard to kind of get them all in one spot right now. And I'm
yeah.
driving out to Home Depot with the mask on, just
yeah.
trying to pick up these lights and bridging them all together. And it's just so that, talk about rationing your patience, it's just so that when the sun goes down, you can change your environment and be a little bit like a college freshman in their dorm room. I'm going for like college freshman dorm room lighting to change, just to make the most of what you have, you know?
Yes. Yeah.
But what I was doing before with the projector, and I have like two of them. I bought a second one.
Yeah.
And I was eating edibles, marijuana edibles.
Uh-huh.
And I also bought the star projector for the ceiling.
Oh.
So I had the star projector for the ceiling.
Yeah.
And then you go to YouTube and there's like relaxing 8-hour videos of like mountains and water, and it looks seamless.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then you can throw another thing over here. And oh, there was one with the shore washing above. So it created this kind of David Hockney-esque collage. Yeah. It's just amazing.
That sounds amazing. I wish we thought to get the projector for the ceiling. Maybe we'll camp again next weekend.
The projector for the, if I were in LA, I would ship it to you. The projector on the ceiling is great. You just put a little disc in there and it's like the Milky Way and it's very photo real.
Oh,
and,
that's amazing.
You know, little toys are okay. The perfect toy is exciting to order.
Yep.
It's exciting to figure out how to configure.
Yep.
It takes long enough to configure that it would take the night. I don't like toys that are easy to set up. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, I mean, it depends. If people are looking at me, I got like, six sets of eyes and they're like, you know.
I don't understand these politics at all. Got it. I want everything I open to take one night to get it to work. Because then in days like these, I get as much out of the experience. And so for me, like have you ever used the Philips Hue?
Oh, they're in my studio. I got them everywhere.
The rooms, the linking. Yeah.
I have this one kind of light strip by this company called Govee.
Uh-huh.
Relatively inexpensive, but it does the thing with sound where it will pulse with the sound. So sometimes when I'm cleaning up the studio, I got the lights pulsing. It's
all you can do. You can't go anywhere, so you decorate your mind by decorating the room you're in.
100%.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wait, did your curtains just open?
No, they've been.
Maybe you were right in front of it.
Oh, I was. I must have been doing this. Yeah.
Is it snowing there? What's happening?
No, it's good. It's actually like 60 degrees out now. I'm out in the Yellowstone area of Montana. Keep it that broad. I came out here a month ago. You know, I always kind of had in the back of my head that this would be a go-to spot. I didn't think it would be because of a pandemic. I thought it would be something a little more on the radar.
Right.
Of a, you know, an environmental thing. And we just shipped out here more than a month ago. And, you know, I'm very careful not to, you know, the road is littered with the bodies of those who have shown where they live behind them.
Yeah. Yes.
So, and I don't even live, I'll be honest with you, I don't live on a very large plot of land, but I can see a lot of land.
Yeah.
And I think if someone saw a picture of that, they wouldn't be able to delineate between where I'm standing, the
and
small area
what's
I'm
not
standing,
yours.
And what's not mine, but can still be seen.
Yeah, yeah.
So this is all anybody gets. This light is coming from snow-capped mountains, but you're not ever going to see that. I mean, you can.
I got
it.
We're talking about avoiding being tone deaf.
Yeah. Well, first of all, I'm actually going to defend every single person who has been criticized for being tone deaf because nobody quite understands the tone. Now, there's a couple people who are out, but like, yeah, a couple people are beyond the pale. But for people who, if nobody can agree what the tone is, then you can't quite incriminate somebody for being deaf to that tone.
Sure.
I am musically tone deaf right now. I don't know what to play.
Yeah.
Are you writing? Can you access your mind of music right now?
Well, I it's just on the other side. I feel the breakthrough about to happen.
Me too. I can't listen to music with lyrics.
Yeah.
Because I think in the back of my mind, I know they don't know what's happening right now.
Sure.
So it's like you don't know. My phone is ringing. Hold on a second. Hello? Hi, Kim. Yes, I'm here, but the mailbox is across the street. Can you drive it in? Oh. Oh, okay. I'll open the gate right now. Oh, that would be lovely. If you, yeah, I'm here. Just call in and I'll let you in. Thanks. Thanks very much. Thanks, Kim. Thanks. Bye.
I've actually, I've already scaled the gate. I'm on the other side, but your dog is barking. I just want you
Kim
to know.
Is my postal delivery person.
Yes.
Who was making sure that I was here. And I said, I am here. Come on in. And she said, well, I don't have the mail now. I just want to make sure you're here. And I'll bring it tomorrow. I said, great. I'll be here tomorrow.
That's good to know.
Great.
Kim looking out.
Kim looking out.
What were we just talking about?
Sorry. We were talking about tone. Oh, music breaking through. And I was saying that.
Musical lyrics.
I just know that the person singing doesn't know what's happening right now. And
right
so
now.
The words feel like a previous software version of
sure.
life.
That makes sense.
And I know that there's going to be a way to conjoin them. But for right now, I go like, yeah, you don't know what's going on. And also, there's no music that touches on this.
Right.
And, I, you know, I think the Imagine video is just... It's there's no song, there's no song. Any song wouldn't have made sense. No, it doesn't. There's we are living in times without any context.
We should. I wish there were songs that we could look up that were popular or written during the Great Plague.
Just Ring Around the Rosie. That's all you have. That's your only jam. Is Ring Around the When I hear Ring Around the Rosie, I just light up. I go, now somebody relates to my situation.
They know how I feel.
Now they know how I feel. I am listening to a ton of jazz.
Yep.
Because number one, jazz was always mystical and right. kind of otherworldly, kind of an alternate universe, right? Yeah. Like, and it's from so long ago. So it's very long time ago in a galaxy far, far away when you listen to jazz, when I listen to jazz. So like Bill Evans, which is like all I really listen to, accesses something in me that I relate to because there's nothing inherent in that music that makes me go, somebody tell this guy what happened in 2020. It doesn't, and there's also enough that gets touched on by jazz in terms of what happens emotionally in the 40s and the 50s that you can kind of get some equilibrium.
Right.
Between listening to jazz music and what's going on. But we just have to wait. And I also feel like I am not sure that anybody after this is going to want to hear this year encapsulated in a song.
I don't know how you put it into words or if this is an emotion that you want to. Like, if you write a breakup song, people are breaking up all the time. Your heart gets broken all the time.
Yeah.
Like, oh. I'll keep this in my spice rack. When I need
right.
that, I'll pull it out.
Right.
I don't know
and,
if we're going to need this.
And there's ecstasy in all that pain. There's ecstasy in that.
Sure.
You're right. We don't know when we're going to need this. And I think what I see this as is kind of like a really slow, low-grade bank hostage standoff.
Yeah.
Where we're all kind of sitting on the floor of the bank. And right yeah. now... The robber, the bad guy has dragged the bank manager into the vault and we're just sitting on the floor.
Yeah.
Dog we're day sort afternoon. Of like, what's that? Yeah.
Dog
yeah, yeah.
day afternoon.
Yeah. And when we get out of the bank, I'm not sure anybody's going to be like, hey, I wrote a song about that time we were all held hostage.
Exactly.
Of the bank.
Exactly.
Now, where's the joy in that? No, there might be joy in rejoicing and reuniting. But I just don't think it's a gold rush to write the song of this. I think this is an era of distraction, worthy distraction, and just being there for each other. And like you said, rationing your patience, really slowing down your brain and not looking at any kind of a date as a finish line. And just float and you'll be okay.
Yeah, I was saying yesterday, just the idea of, you know, this actually happens to me more when I'm on the road, where you got to pee, and you're like,
uh-huh.
no, I got to pee, and you get up to your room, and you put the key in,
and
the key doesn't work.
Yes.
I found like yeah. I was doing that with the patience. It's like, wait a minute, you told me it was going to be 2 weeks. Yeah. I used up all my patience because I thought that's all I needed, and now I'm going to pee my patience pants.
Right, that's right.
So just knowing I got to keep a little reserve of patience and grace for folks.
And you can grow more as you go.
Yeah.
The weather's going to get better. I think that's a double-edged sword, the weather getting better.
Yeah.
But I noticed throughout all this, when the weather was really nasty, I felt worse.
Right.
It sort of augmented the situation in a more negative way. I also itemized it for the first time yesterday. I went, what would make me feel like my life was back to normal? Oh, you God. Should do it too. I went, if I can go to the studio and if I can go to two restaurants that are open, I'll feel like life is normal for me. What do you think to you would make you feel like, okay, the rest of it can take its time?
If I have the option to hug anybody I want.
Oh, man. Way to undercut mine. Mine was like, if I could help my career out by writing more songs.
I mean, my thing is like, just my impulse is just, I'm just hardwired. If I see somebody I know, it's just like, let's hug. I was actually teaching Hendrix the other day. We were hugging and he was trying to get away. And I was like, hey, buddy, do you realize we're putting our hearts together? And he was like, what? Oh. I was like, my heart is here and your heart is there. And then when we do this, we're touching hearts. And he was like, oh, I like touching hearts. And like, I can't touch people. It's weird.
It's, well, are you around people very often that you can't touch? Because I'm not around anybody anyway.
So every day at 4, we go, like, our kid's school is probably, I don't know, three quarters of a mile up the road. And so we go, and there's, like, this little area in the front of the school where the kids kind of ride their bikes in circles and don't touch each other. But you see parents who, you know, you all share the exact same experience. You all have the same frustrations. And they're 8 feet away from you, and you just go,
oh, I see. But what you really want to do is go, it's okay. Yeah.
It's the ante of every possible way that I'm wired.
Let me ask you a question. If given the opportunity, at not a considerable cost, a nominal fee, you will be medically comatized and then revived as soon as this is all over, and you will not feel any passage of time. And everybody in your life will be taken care of. It'll be just fine. It'll be just fine. Or maybe the whole family. That's a family discount.
Yeah.
Everybody gets put in a pod. And it's almost like, it's like the space movies where you have to go to deep sleep because it takes so long to get to the next galaxy.
Sure.
Would you do it?
I'm leaning real strong towards hell yeah.
Carlos is saying, sign me up.
I feel like I've gotten a lot of lessons out of this time. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I'm going to, it's like reading my, 10th grade algebra book. I think I got it. I don't need
Right.
I think I got all I need. I can go to sleep now.
It's probably orders of magnitude of bad news from this point on.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, I would creatively, probably, this is going to, I feel like I'm sowing seeds just in terms of what my process is. And trying to figure out what my voice is and what I want that to be. This has been incredibly helpful for me. And like I told you about that pedal, like I was messing around with this pedal earlier today. I'm so inspired. I can't wait. Like, I feel like I started singing through this thing and I feel like I can make a whole record with just
it's this. Great. I remember having one of those pedals early on.
Yeah.
I think I wrote 1983 on it because I put this bongo patch under it. So I went, dum, dip, dip, bum, bum. It was like, and it was totally off.
Yeah.
I think songwriters are looking for ways to trick their brain to make it sound like them plus something else while they're writing.
Sure.
Yeah, if you can get out of sounding like you while you're writing, you're in heaven.
Yeah, no doubt. You want to play a game?
Oh, I'd love to.
Fantastic. You know what? It's so weird. You're probably one of my best friends that I've done this with, and everybody else that I've been on one of these things, I'm always just effusive about letting them know how much I love them and how glad I am that they are in my life, and I've neglected to do that. It's great to see you. We don't do this nearly enough.
I know.
I love you. I know that you're always just not even an arm's length away from me emotionally and spiritually.
Me too. And you know what's funny about that is, you and I talk frequently, but not hyper frequently. We keep in touch a lot. I found that during the shutdown, there's a lot of kind of vicarious feeling of shutdown through other people being shut down. So me knowing where you are in the world gives me an extra feeling of freedom when I know that you were about to go on tour.
Right.
That's what Instagram was good for. It's like, oh, David's here on the radar.
Oh, sure.
Scotty's here. Oh, Zane Carney is here. And knowing everyone else is grounded gives me an even deeper sense, this feeling of, oh man, you know, the whole vicarious radar, because we're a part of a community, you know, the people we play with, the people we know, and we're always aware of who's out and who's in.
Sure.
Meaning, who's right now on the road? Who might need a check-in?
Right.
You know, because I always said the people at home are mission control for the people on the road. And they switch, you know? And to know that everybody is now not going a place would seem not to make a difference if they're not in your immediate surroundings. But you can feel it like, oh, man, David can't tour.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And so we are definitely connected that way. We're also monsters with a metaphor.
Hey, is that the raspberry spindrift?
This is the grapefruit spindrift. Do you know about the spindrift?
Oh, I do know about the spindrift.
Oh.
It's good stuff.
It's like half carbonated?
Yeah.
It's half swung. And it's chuggable seltzer.
Yeah.
And then you're done with it. I want a cooler. I want a big office cooler of it.
Like a Gatorade sideline, the big orange thing on the sideline?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Watch how many sips I take all at once. Of carbonated liquid.
That's great.
I'd be spitting up if I had that regular drink.
There's no burp.
It's got the right. You realize there is a million ways to carbonate a liquid.
Yeah. Yes.
There was a game.
Topo Chico.
I just got hip to Topo Chico.
It's made from the devil. How did it, like, you can open a Topo Chico and leave it open for 2 years and it's still carbonated? I don't understand.
Still carbonated. The idea that's made by the devil is it holds that right now is in the lead for the best reason, best explanation. Here comes the spindrift. I tried it for the first time about 2 weeks ago, and I found it to have the same carbonation profile as a beer.
Yeah.
Which is to say, there's the initial big bubble response, and then it's a really long tail. It has reverb decay of bubbles. And the bubbles get tinier and pricklier as it goes.
Yeah.
And then you just want to take the ride again with another sip.
Yeah.
Boom, big bubbles, medium-sized bubbles, zing.
It's like if a bunch of ants just went loose in your mouth, but they weren't right. It was just like they just like a big explosion as they're all sprayed into your mouth, and then they just run away, and you're like, that was cool. I want to do it again.
Do it again.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then I mentioned I was drinking it on Current Mood, and then Topo Chico reached out, and they were like, can we send you a cooler and some Topo Chico? And I was like, normally I don't respond to these, but yes, you can. So I might have taken advantage of my position a little bit, but who wouldn't for free Topo Chico?
Hey,
and it's not even a matter of it being free. It's a matter of it being in your house.
100%.
If they even called me and said, we'd like to give you an opportunity to buy more, I'd be like, thank you so much for this.
Yes. We're going to give you the freshest of the Topo Chico.
Oh, give me that. I always check that born on date. Now, Topo Chico looks very similar to a Chula Chip popsicle in terms of the font.
Yeah.
Chupa Chip. They're very similar. I wonder if they're owned by the same company. Same font.
Same font for sure. In the same font family.
In the same font family. I'd like to look that up, but I won't.
Oh, you know, somebody, I was supposed to, I said I was going to do an advice column. Somebody asked me a question yesterday, and now I can't remember. I think they asked me, what song do I go to listen to when I'm upset? I'm sorry, person that asked that question. I don't have a particular song, because I get upset in lots of different ways, so I need lots of different music.
You get upset in lots of different ways?
Yeah, I internalize stuff.
Mm.
Way too much. As I get older, I feel like I'm kind of, you know, I had a really good friend of mine who was supposed to come over for Thanksgiving dinner, right? And we do kind of this orphans thing. We invite people in LA that don't have family. And so the day before, I think it was, he was like, hey, I'm going to go do this. No, it wasn't the day before. It was the day of. Hey, well, what time will you guys be eating? Because I'm going to go do this other thing. And I just want to know what time I come over. So Sloan knows this person, but they're more my friend than they are hers. So she kind of gives me, like, these are the kind of friends that you have that just, like, cancel on the day. Because, you know, she's setting everything out. She's making sure everything's around. And so I was pissed. I was like, what kind of, who does that? And I wasn't going to say anything. I was just going to swallow it and then see that person and have to swallow it every time I saw him. But I was like, if I really care about this person, I'm going to let them know that wasn't the thing. Like, I'm actually showing them love by confronting them and us possibly blowing up and we get to the other side. So yep. I say all that to say, I'm trying to not hold on to things. Cause my go-to is like, I'll just hold on to this. Cause maybe there's something about me that causes this particular exchange to happen. And I'm like, you know what? I'm gonna just let people have it.
There are three possible scenarios when it comes to upsetting somebody. And there's only three, and there should only be three. I know there's more, but there should only be three. And if you live by the three scenarios and you suggest or insist that everyone else in your life do so, you will be happy. Number one is I never upset you, in which case I don't have to do anything. Number two is I've upset you and you've gotten over it, in which case I don't have to do anything.
Deal with it. Yeah.
The third one is I've upset you and you will let me know I've upset you and I can apologize, in which case I don't have to do anything. Right. In all three scenarios, you don't have to do anything.
Yeah.
So if you live by that, where, okay, look, did I say something yesterday during David's lunch hour that he might have been upset with me? Well, he either didn't catch it, or he did and he got over it, or he did and he'll let me know it upset him.
Right.
So in all three scenarios, I need not worry.
Right. Right.
And isn't that great if everybody signs up to do that?
Man, that would be amazing.
God, it'd be amazing if everybody just gets on that. Everybody just gets on that plan.
Check this out.
Mm-hmm.
There's a friend of mine I haven't seen in 8 years or so. He used to live in L.A. He was an engineer, and he moved, somewhere in the Midwest. I get a call from him. He's like, hey, man, I need to talk to you about something. It's like, okay, cool. He's like, I've been sober for a while, and there was always this one exchange that we had that just really bothered me. I said this thing, and it was like the most racist thing that I could imagine, and it didn't seem to bother you at the time, but it has stuck with me, and I just wanted to call and apologize for it. And I was like, I don't know what you're talking about.
What we should do, and look, obviously that's for him to offload that, and that's important, but what we should do is go like, hey, do you remember that time I said something fucked up to you? And if you say, I really don't, I go, all right, next question, like next conversation, let's go get lunch. The human heart can't do that. We need to remind the other person of what we said. So basically, risk hurting them anew or for the first time, just to be able to say, that was fucked up what I said.
Yes.
But you would think if the person said, I have no memory of you ever upsetting me, that they'd go, oh, okay then, you want to get some ice cream? But we can't do that. We have to go all the way through. We have to go, David, I said, then go through it. And you go, David, that was fucking horrible what I said to you. And you're like, okay, that was horrible. And you're like, okay, here we are. I'm sorry for having said that.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, the thing is, I'm actually a little bit pissed because I was like, well, what did you say? And he was like, well, I don't want to say it again. So now he has this feeling of like, whoo, got that off my chest.
And now you have to wonder whether you let him off, whether you let someone off the hook.
He's like, well, what I said was, Nick. No,
no, it's so complicated. It's so complicated emotions, you know, like, and basically it's not just emotions, it's interactions, right? Everybody, for the most part, unless you are a searing asshole, in which case people wouldn't fuck with you anyway, but most people are just trying their best to connect.
Right.
And are saying things that are their best guess at how to make another person happy.
Yeah, tripping over yourself.
Most of the mistakes people make are in attempt to please another person.
Right.
And so it's. I mean, you have this. People come up to you and they talk to you in a way where they need a certain amount of approval. Like they need some, like you find yourself in a situation where you're helping people along quite a bit, encouraging them. It's cool. Just right on. Go, right. You know,
yep.
And I'm in that position too, you know, and I think that taught me a lot about how most people in the world are just trying to appeal to another person. Most of the mistakes I've made in my life personally came out of my trying aggressively to appeal to somebody.
Right.
You know?
That,
I want to make conversation. I want to try to be funny, so this person says I'm funny. What's that?
Just like, I'm not a good arguer in person, because if I don't get a response that is, I really understand what you're saying, or like if we disagree on something and I tell you my point and you don't say anything, I will completely spin out of control. We're like,
oh, well, yeah.
So what I meant was,
oh no, I'll spin out of control if I say goodnight and you don't say goodnight.
Yes.
I'll stay up all night. He didn't say goodnight.
That was weird.
Is there a little OCD in that?
Well, I tell you what it is. It's narcissism.
Explain.
Well, I just think because you're like, no one's going out of their way to make you. People don't have enough time in their lives, enough emotional space to try to make your day worse. And the people that do that, you don't want to fuck with anyway.
That's my point. There are a certain number of those people, but they're such outliers. You wouldn't make it 5 days being friends with them.
Yeah, you don't.
The rest of the people, the rest of the world just have the best of intentions. And also, think about this. If you stayed on this show, I would say for 6 hours, you would say something offensive. And you talk nonstop, you'd say something offensive within the 6 hours. It's the same thing with relationship. It's just law of averages. And what I found was very interesting was that in person, people are so willing, ready, and able to understand each other. To go, I know what you meant. I know what you meant. No, I know what you meant. And online are the exact opposite.
Oh, that's so true.
Online, everything is read. Like, did I hear some conflict there? Does that mean, well, you said that the sky isn't blue at night. Does that mean you're saying that colors, are you saying now that, you know, blah, 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 and then all of a sudden gets into a thing where you're like, In person, there's this idea. I hear people say it all the time out here, especially, no, you're fine.
Oh, yeah.
No, you're fine.
And it's,
by the way,
and it's instantly like, okay, cool.
You could be telling, not you, but somebody could be telling me something at dinner and I couldn't know the first thing of what they're talking about. What do we do? Oh yeah, right on.
Yeah, totally.
Like blind thumbs up, because we know the other person sitting across from us is good. We know they're cool. We know they're all right. And when you flip it online, no matter what, if you don't know that person, everything is seen as a threat. And it's so wild. It's really wild. That's why friends help each other along and go, no, I know what you meant.
Right.
I guess there's a way and a half you could have seen that in an upsetting way. And it's you. I never would have thought that. Right. I wish we did that more online. It's like, no, most people are good and they mean well, you know. I just think people are wimps, and people are lovers and wimps in real life. Mm-hmm. And they're haters and tough guys on the internet.
Beyond, it couldn't be a wider
cast. Yeah, because there's nothing at stake.
Right.
Like I know I'm privileged and I don't get a ton of online hate, but I don't quite understand people who are personally horrified by people writing the worst thing they can think of, because it's like the only place they can shout something terrible and get away with it.
I mean, but there is a part of me, like if I put something up on YouTube and I see like it's got 700 million thumbs up and 8 thumbs down, I'm like, how can I get to, I need this, like, what
not
was
me.
What are those?
You know what I say? 8 wise guys. There's 8 wise guys out there.
Yeah, no doubt.
Well, you know, I talk to artists about this a lot. Like when someone's on their first record and they're on the rocket ride, as I call it, and they're pulling G's on the way up the rocket ride. Everybody screenshot this. It's very difficult to gauge what is hate and what is not. And I will reach out all the time and go, listen, when you play the game a few more years, you will see the first 3 words of a comment that's meant to be hateful and be like, Lord, okay.
Right.
And the good thing about hateful comments on the internet are they out themselves within 4 words.
Sure.
Hate, thankfully, is not very clever. Love is very clever.
Right.
There are very, very many ways to excite somebody and intrigue somebody with ways to tell them you love them. I haven't heard a very exciting, hateful thing about me in a long time, which is why I go, oh, okay.
Well,
4 words I go by.
I mean, the thing that I used to get tripped up on, and I still do a little bit, is what happens after I put my art into the world. I'm only supposed to care up until the moment that it leaves.
Yeah. Well,
I have no control over it. Well, I'm supposed to beat myself up about it internally, and then I get dumb, and I'm like, you got to go out into the world. Like, how you respond to it, I just have no control over it. It's like, I meant what I said.
Yep.
Because you don't apologize for art. You don't put something out and say, I'm, you know, sorry I wrote that. You know, you do it, you put it out, and it is what it is. But we all have this habit of, you put up a post, you got to go back to see how many likes it has.
I know.
Put out a song. How's it chart? How many spins?
I know. Feels good to put up a shit post every once in a while, though. It's good for you. It's good for you to put up a post that gets almost nothing. Go good. It's not why I did it. There's also what I'm learning. Thank God. I love having learned this in my life. You probably know this, too. There's a life after the life of a song.
Sure.
And that's the life that matters.
Right.
You make Born and Raised. You feel good about it. You put it out in the world. The world goes, huh? And then you go, I really thought that was something. And then, you know, 8 years later, people go, that's my favorite record.
Sure.
That taught me that there's making the record, there's the release of the record, and then there's the third part, which is the most important part, which is how it ages in the universe. And all of your music, I was thinking about Me and the Leaves the other day.
Uh-huh.
That's your song, right? It's called Me and the Leaves. I thought about that. That song's 25 years old.
Yeah.
And it's still important to me.
Thank you very much for saying that. I mean, it's when you put something out in the world, I don't know. I wish I could get to the point where I could put up a post. I could compose a thought and you do it and you just move on. And the person that made me know how valuable that is was Dylan. Cause I watched I wasn't really a huge Dylan fan, but then I watched the Don't Look Back, the Scorsese thing.
Oh yeah. Don't look back. You mean No Direction Home.
No Direction Home. I think about how many lives he had. He didn't have time to look back. He was like, I'm doing this thing and I'm moving on. Like, can you imagine anybody in our day and age that had like half of his success playing a show where people are at the show going, you suck, we hate you, and you just continue this thing that you've decided to do. Like, we're so reactionary.
See, now, and this is maybe magical thinking. I don't know for sure. I think he went and took a piss after that show and went, fuck, 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 fuck.
Yeah.
That's what I think.
I mean,
no one ever thinks about it. I mean, it's very easy in revisionist history to say, like, and he didn't care.
Right.
I think he cares. I think everybody cares.
He didn't stop. So if he went and took a pee, he's like, fuck, 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 fuck. He was like, you know what?
I started. Too late now.
I pushed his cart down the hill. I'm going.
That's right. But I don't think that he was like,
oh,
you know,
yeah.
I think he probably was like getting ready to get in the limo and stopped off to use the. But I would like to think so. I would like to think that because that would mean that we're all in the same boat. The other thing is, I was talking to someone about this yesterday. I think my superpower is that I am just absolutely 100% resistant to discouragement. I don't get discouraged.
You know what? And I will say, in terms of it being superpower or a gift, from the day that I met you, I've always been like, whatever that guy says he's going to do, I don't know if he's going to do it, but he's not going to quit trying to do it.
I don't have. Now, it doesn't mean that I nail everything. I certainly don't. But when I don't nail it, I go, okay, see another one.
Yeah.
So every time I put a song out, I mean, in very rare, like when I put out, I guess I just feel like I knew that wasn't going to do. I said to my label boss, which is a horrible thing to say to your label boss, I just need everybody to hear it three times.
Right.
I just want each person to hear it twice or three times and I'll be good. But then, you know, my whole career, I've been like, clarity, this is going to work. Or like, who says this is going to work? There were a couple songs, I mean, there were several songs in my career. I was like, how can this not work? And the world was like, let us show you.
Yeah.
And
how about now? How about now? Is there sound? Is there sound? Is there sound? Hey, excuse me. Is there sound? I wish I could hear you. I can't tell if there's sound or not. There is sound. Awesome. I just got on another phone because I got a bunch of phones. I have a separate life as a spy. The bad part is, I guess, right next to my face. I don't know if John's coming back. Let me see. Lunch break guest. Does it look any better? Because this is an iPhone 11. Let's see. Well, that might be it. Did you guys have fun? That was fun. I miss my friend. There are 444 people on this thing right now. That's kind of cool. Oh, well, I think that might be it. Yeah, I don't see him on here right now. Instagram, the whole cutting you off after an hour. Super lame. Super duper, super duper lame. All right, well, you guys, I will be back tomorrow. Hey, thanks for the big ups on Hush Money. I was going to talk to John about his guitar on Forever Young, but we didn't, wait, holy crikey. All right, man, I think I'm out. Wait. Yeah, my phone is not doing anything. Whenever I hit, like, the view thing, it just switches the camera to the other side. I think my phone has communicable disease. My phone has an STD. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed that. I had a great time. I'm gonna actually call my friend on the phone now and catch up that way. But before I go, just a PSA for you guys. If you get any mail from somebody purporting to be David Ryan Harris, asking you for gift cards, it is not me. I'll show you this exchange. So this friend of mine, Mitch in Amsterdam, he sent me a text. And he was like, "Hey man, what? I swear, man. Instagram is just not ready. Like, I didn't even hit the thing that spins a camera around. I just spent the camera around. All right. You can still hear me, right? Wait, he just commented. Wait, where? Boo. I don't see him. Let me try this one more time. One more time. Yeah, but not, whenever I do like the, I'm hitting a thing with the double face where you invite people and it just keeps spinning my camera around. Hold on, give me 1 second. Oh, wait. He's gonna get lunch with the lunch break lady. Go live with lunch break. Here we go.
But you didn't bring, there's no mail though. But you didn't bring any, but if you don't have any mail, just bring the mail tomorrow.
Hello?
Hey!
Hey. My point was, I only do it for the distance between coming up with the idea and the combustion of the thing and then letting other people hear what I made. And then,
yes.
At this point, I go, let's do another thing. Let's go around again. I don't, you know, we'll see what happens in 5 years. See if it works or not.
Well, I applaud and am always a huge fan and get a huge amounts of inspiration from your quest and your drive to like do stuff. So let's get to this game before we get cut off again.
Yes, we have another 58 minutes.
Game's called Songversations. Basically, there are 100 questions in a deck of 50 cards.
Mm-hmm.
And I hate holding my phone, but now I'm going to do it.
Was that the cold open? And now we're into segment one. This is the game segment.
exactly.
Great.
So you can, I can choose a card at random, or you can pick a number 1 to 50.
You choose. You feel it out.
Card at random. All right. This is actually kind of cool. And you may or may not remember this. What was your favorite song when you were 10 years old?
Okay. That would be 1987. I should call it 88. Most of 88. Are you by a computer right now?
Mm-hmm.
Can you put in like top hits 1988 and I'll tell you which one.
Yep.
I mean, part of me feels like I have to pick what's going on in 88. So it's right before Guns N' Roses, Def Leppard. It would have been like Armageddon It by Def Leppard or something.
The end of that year, that was a pretty good year. So we have Faith by George Michael, that Needs You Tonight, NXS.
You say to come inside when you're ready to, but you can't because you're already dead.
Yeah.
Like the head of your bone, like a bed in a bottom, bed in a. You got it. But are you getting it?
I'm not getting it.
It's just fun. By the way, the cool thing about Def Leppard is that the more music you listen to as you get older, you go back and listen to them and you can feel where they were pulling from. You're like, oh, I know what he's doing. Yeah, they're doing.
They actually weren't even, I'm looking at this top, Pour Some Sugar on Me.
Pour Some Sugar on Me. That would have been great for me. What else is on there?
Okay, so we got Faith, Need You Tonight, Got My Mind Set on You. I love
that. I would say Got My Mind Set on You. I had the single. My mom loved it. Wasn't it great to share a song you loved with your mom?
It really was. Mom wasn't was like that all the Michael best? McDonald stuff.
Yeah, my mom loved Roy Orbison, Only the Lonely.
Oh, that was so good.
You know, it was really nice sharing it. My mom loved Moody Blues, In My Wildest Dreams.
Oh, really?
Once upon a time, the universe was ours. Do you know this song?
Yeah.
Do you have it? Could you pull it up right now?
Hold on.
Or do you have to go into your TCP/IP preferences?
TCP/IP, exactly. But Sweet Child of Mine comes in at number 5. So that was probably.
I dug Sweet Child of Mine, but I really love the hyper melodic sweet, you know, like I will never be ultra gritty cool because I just love
melody.
All the sound effects on that Moody Blues tune. I mean, there's nothing quite as perfectly saccharine as that recording. By the way, the whole thing starts out with intergalactic whistles and noises and stuff. Remember this?
Yeah, here we go.
Like, digging on a production level.
I'm in.
Just let it run.
Oh. Is that theremin?
It must be.
Here we go. Like, everything is
recorded ever talks about
so
it.
Well.
It's perfect. No one talks about it. Will you turn it up so I can hear a little more?
Yeah. Your mom dug this.
My mom dug it. I dug it. Yeah, it was really nice when you have those moments. You know, the rest of it, Dr. Feelgood. You know, my dad couldn't. My parents couldn't take that.
Yeah, there was definitely a lot of music I was listening to that my parents hated. This was '88 was an interesting time for me, because I graduated from high school in '86, and I was just starting to kind of I was moving out of the phase of music is magic and I don't know how it's made, I don't know how it's put together, mm-hmm. and moving into like I'm doing it myself, which
I remember that for me, yeah.
I just started to listen to music a little differently, and there are a lot of songs on here that I remember thinking they suck. I was just kind of getting my like right. bowed up my right. chest thing, like you know. But yep. there's some songs like "Wishing Well" by Terrence and Darby's on here. That was
incredible, incredible. Cupid like the hourglass, wasting time without
you, man. So good.
You know, and it's funny because when I was younger, I would sing those sort of top line things, and as I get older, like, do you feel like you've moved through your life with moving your focus from instrument to instrument and how you think about records or
oh, the way sure.
you hear a song? I think about the long chords on Wishing Well now. Right. You know, I think about what must have been like a Rhodes or something down there.
Right.
Yeah, I usually follow the bass. The bass will steer you right. The bass will never lead you wrong if you're trying to write a song or understand a song. The bass guitar, the bass sets, I do everything by the bass.
Make or break the whole thing. You know, when I'm writing my own stuff or doing my own productions, I actually do bass last because there's so much pressure.
Oh, that's interesting. Well, but doesn't the bass, well, even if you don't do the bass, but you think about that, you're always thinking about the bass. Aren't you? Like, isn't every, especially if you're doing the bass last, you're sort of carving out everything based on what you know the bass is going to do.
Well, you know, okay, so. Some people, when they put puzzles together, they put the outside together first.
Yeah, just first, yeah.
So yeah. I do my song and I do the edges last.
That's hilarious. I'm always thinking about the bass because the bass is the harmonic DNA of what's happening. So, like, even if it's not the bass doing the chords, but the bass doing voicings.
Sure.
So my most recent song, "You Are Still You," which my dad loved because it's written off of this old sort of 1940s, 50s template.
Yeah.
I'm always thinking about my vocal and it's my vocal and a bass in my mind. That's all right. It is. You know,
I'm actually getting to that. And I love it. Like I wrote a song with someone and I was putting the track together and something happened. And the way I had things routed, I muted everything except the bass, the vocal and the drums. And I was like, this isn't how this song was written, but the bass spell out the chords and the,
yes.
you know, and
the bass is the music theory machine. That's the music theory engine for the whole song.
For yeah, sure. Yeah. For sure. The flip side of that card was, who was your best friend as a kid? And did you listen to music together?
Yeah. My best friend as a kid was Chris Parker.
Mm-hmm.
And I would go to his house and we would buy Circus magazine and we'd buy Rip magazine.
Oh yeah.
And we would cut the pages out. And we yep. would paste them on the masking tape. You know, you make the masking tape loop.
Yeah.
I mean, masking tape in a magazine as a kid.
Yeah.
Forget it. I remember growing up also, I would buy like Guitar Player magazine or Guitar World magazine or whatever. And I'd buy two of them so I could use both sides.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah. On my wall. Yeah, yeah, sure.
But at that time, it was Motley Crue, Def Leppard, Poison, Warrant, all those bands. And you know, it's funny, I was just thinking about my talking has reminded me of another thing to talk about. You see this? I was hearing myself talking, which reminded me of another thing to say. When you look back, I don't know if you've thought of this, when you look back at all of those Hit Parader, Circus, and Rip magazine photos,
yep.
you realize, oh, those are done between soundcheck and show at the venue.
Oh, no doubt. No doubt.
Like, you look at the old Motley Crue photographs, they're in the arena showers,
right?
Like Vince Neil's like posing in front of like a hand dryer.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like those backgrounds now, were just does that set up it, in a heartbeat.
Does that make it more or less cool?
It just makes it no, it makes it really cool for me to understand yeah. now, because I remember being a kid looking at it going, there's Brett Michaels just doing this, and there's like just like a pink background, and you're like, he's just appearing as a rock star. And then once you go and you play the arenas, you're like, oh, there's no time. These guys had the photographers show up, watch the second half of soundcheck, and then shoot for a half. You probably only got a half an hour with those guys, but that's where all of the shots came from, were local photographers shooting for Hit Parader in between soundcheck and show.
Which also helped cement the thing, like you sort of felt like, man, they must be dressed like this all the time. I'm sure this is a Tuesday, and they just like showed up at the house. It's like, no, they're about to go to work.
They're about to go to, that's how it happened. And that was their Instagram. Now we do it in between soundcheck and show on Instagram.
I had my friend Audrey Hanen I went to high school with. I was a huge Van Halen fan. She didn't like Van Halen, but she liked Def Leppard. So we would get those magazines, and like I would give her any Def Leppard pictures in mine, and she would give me any like, cool David Lee Roth or Eddie Van Halen shots.
But I feel like there was just more Def Leppard in those magazines than Van Halen. There was some Van Halen, but don't think that Def Leppard was really cranking out the photos?
I think so. 88 had to be, this was definitely
88's the Hysteria tour.
But for Van Halen, it's like,
OU812? OU812. Maybe in between 5150 and OU812. Yeah. Do you know the name of every person in Def Leppard in the Hysteria days?
That's Phil Collins. Is that
Phil Collins singular?
Phil Collins, sorry. Is it Campbell? Vivian Campbell?
Well, Vivian later? Campbell now. We'll accept it now. But who did he replace?
Replaced. Give me an initial.
Come on, Steve. Get it.
What's his last name?
Steve Clark.
Steve Clark. I got to tell you, of course, I know Joe Elliott. Who was the bass player in that band?
Rick Savage.
Oh, all right.
The greatest bass player name. It is Rick Savage. Rick Savage. Yeah, and then Rick Allen.
Rick Allen.
Chad is here. You want to? Oh, Chad won't want to say hi to you because he wouldn't want to be on Instagram Live. Hold on. I'm on Instagram Live on David Ryan Harris's show.
Well, hello, David Ryan Harris's show.
What's up, Chad?
How's it going?
We're gonna get a chat. Holy cow, Chad! You know what is most interesting? What I most want to know is what the bottom half of your face is doing right now. Are you clean shaven or do you have Oh, there we go. That's my guy.
Oh, he's going for it.
It's massive. It's massive.
Chad has come to pick me up. We're gonna head out. We're gonna do hood rat stuff with our friends.
Oh, I love it. I love it.
I love you. I love so you. So good to see your face. This is effortless, as evidenced by how long we could just keep talking.
We're just gonna hang out. I don't know what we'll talk about. We'll just hang out. But I hate that we don't do this just normally. Well, not on Instagram Live, but I've had more people FaceTime me in the past 3 weeks than I have the entire time I had an iPhone.
FaceTime's the winner here. FaceTime's the winner of all of this. So well, listen, great when you want to hate on stuff, you too. Just FaceTime me. We'll hate on stuff together.
Yeah, fantastic. Hey, Chad, I see your silhouette, so you're still there. I see you in the door.
Oh, in the window.
Yeah.
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 All right. Hey, Chad, Harris. Love you too, man.
I love you, buddy.
All right, Bye. Man. Talk to you guys later. You.
Take care. See Bye, you, everyone. Thanks for watching. That was awesome. This was
fun. Bye. All right, man. So that was great. That was lots of good times. I'll be back tomorrow. I got a guest for tomorrow too. I will tell you, doing these every day at this time, it seemed like a good idea, but I don't get enough of the morning to do morning stuff. And then it's like, so like now it's like 2:30 and I feel like, I don't know, it's messing up my productivity. I feel like maybe I'm going to do these Monday, Wednesday, Friday or something. I'm not really sure. I can't tell you who's on for tomorrow. It's always a surprise. I saw somebody on here a little while ago that I want to be a guest. So hopefully we can tee her up for next week. So yeah, that was it. I got some stories for you tomorrow. And that's it. You guys take care of each other. Check on your people. Nige, I'm in my studio in, Mount Washington, California. So I'm going to get out of here. I'll see you tomorrow. Let me know what song you want to hear tomorrow, and we'll get after it. Check on your people. Check on your people. Miss you too, Drake. Miss you too, Christine. You changed your hair color. Did you change your hair color back? All right. I'm out. Carlton, what's up? Gabe, look at this. Priscilla, Terrence. All these people I know. All right, for real. I'm out. Love y'all.